One of the key questions of the day is, do you have to have a very solid grounding in calmness and centeredness and the capability to do that before you get into some really intense practice such as the maybe practice, the maybe meditation? And the answer is yes, you do need to be grounded in it. Apropos of that, there is this disagreement or contention between, for instance, Buddhism, Theravada Buddhism, and the mindfulness movement. Was it, I don't know, how about you say that, Vipassana or something, where the Theravada Buddhists say, no, you need to be solidly grounded in calmness and centeredness first before you get onto these higher practices. And those who are leading this mindfulness movement tend to say, no, just you can just jump right in and just do it. It's direct. The fact is, you must be grounded if you're going to do these super intense practices. The most intense practice I know of is the one that Holy Spirit just suggested to me yesterday. It is the maybe meditation. The maybe meditation is the hammer. If you want to bring the hammer down, that is the way to do it. But it is so intense that it requires tremendous capability. So I would say that without question, you know, the Western way is we're all in a hurry, we're all impatient, and no place more impatient than the Silicon Valley, actually. And let's get it done yesterday. So fast food, fast spirit food, spirituality, let's just, you know, watch our breath, concentrate, go into samadhi, deep concentration, realize our, you know, true nature, pure spaciousness, and the clear light, and boom, we're done, did it. You know, just could do it in 10 days. And whereas in the East, it tends to have been slower, and you dedicate your life to it. You may spend decades of gradual getting better and better at being centered and calm and be able to handle it. Because I've been working at it my entire life, really, and not along any particular lines, but just working as intensely as I possibly can to try and come up with what works. So there's no question, when I use this new technique, this new practice, this is a practice, the maybe meditation, the maybe mantra, the maybe meditation. This requires the utmost practice and discipline to be able to remain centered, full stop in the now with this. It is a sledgehammer. We just took out a bathtub, cast iron bathtub. Well, how we do it? Sledgehammer. I broke it in two. Well, you break it in two with a sledgehammer and carry it out. It's too heavy to carry in one piece. So this delusion that is we're in the grip of, what are we in the grip of actually? I'll say in a moment, but this delusion is so intense. We need a sledgehammer to really get to break through. And the maybe meditation is a sledgehammer for sure. But just like busting up a cast iron tub, you know, you have to know what you're doing actually. You have to have confidence, and you have to really know how to strike it properly, and that comes with a lot of practice and confidence. And so in using this heavy duty meditation, it just sort of melts the whole determinant belief system. You have to be, you know, really confident and poised and a real pro at maintaining your composure, your full composure, not just superficial composure, but in other words, don't struggle with the struggle. This is the key. Don't struggle with the struggle. Otherwise, for sure, you're going to have trouble. So what I have seen in the Western world over the last, let's say, 60 years, we'll say 58, because I've only been here 58, so, but let's say, you know, 58 years, is we're in too much of a hurry. And that gets us into big trouble. See, everybody here is after status, money, status. They want degrees, they want, you know, to pass tests, to get grades, to graduate, to get this. They want to be able to have a resume. They want, it's such a rat race. The Western world is such a rat race that nobody wants to spend the time. I was forced to spend the time because I got so ill. So I had nothing else to do. But so there's a few fortunate ones, but mostly we're all looking for the quick way, the quick benefit. Now, the maybe mantra isn't the quick way, it's the sledgehammer way, which requires a tremendous grounding prior to using it in order to be effective. Otherwise, it'll just be intellectualized. But when you can really take the position of maybe, the total conceptual position of maybe, this just absolutely is the sledgehammer that breaks the eggshell open, as it were, and the fullness, which Buddhists call sunyata, but is the emptiness. It's not empty. It's not really being presented properly in a lot of explanations I've read. It's not emptiness, it's not voidness at all. It's the form of everything. It's what form everything takes. I think an ant just went across the lens. It's the form of everything. Simultaneousness is the form of spontaneity. What form does pure spontaneity take? It is this clear light. It's not absence, it's total inclusiveness, total inclusion. It's not the void at all. There is no void. But in pop spirituality, you know, these terms are all thrown around. Voidness, emptiness. It's like, oh yeah, I know what they're talking about or something. But that's a very strong misinterpretation that really confuses people. So to get to that, this maybe meditation is very powerful. For those who have prepared. Now, there may be some in this world, absolutely, there must be some, you would think, who are very grounded. It could be in any tradition. See, it doesn't matter what tradition you use to get truly centered and grounded. We use the continuity problem, the mood of repentance, the confession. I have a severe continuity problem. It's the only problem that I have. Full stop in the wow, full stop in the now, full stop in the burn. Sitting quietly, not moving, committed to no matter what happens, you're going to continue to sit here in one place, don't move your place. No eating while you're doing this. No scratching your face, you know, all the distractions. You keep just steady, stay calm, stay quiet. No teaching, no teacher, no student sort of standpoint. Indeterminate, full stop in the indeterminacy. Full stop in the now means full stop in the indeterminacy. No answer. Full stop in no answer. Full stop in no answer. Okay. Now, practicing this most definitely is opening the door to looking at what's called, what some people would say, emptiness, and realizing, no, that's not emptiness. That's everythingness. That's totality. That's the form of totality. That's the form of freedom, absolute freedom. And you're saying, well, that's home, that's home. So it opens the door to your home. Now, why is there a door there? Because what we tried to do is we tried to change the nature of reality. We tried to change the nature of reality. This is what all this existence is. That's what we're trying to change, what we are. We think that this dream of existence is going to change what we are. We're trying to change what we are. Just why? For the heck of it. Just because we're super adventurous and we thought this would really be quite an adventure. Well, it has been, hasn't it? It's been quite an adventure. One might say it's been a misadventure, actually. Jesus called it the detour into fear, right? Yeah. Anyway, it's futile. So what we've been doing is we've been engaged in futility. And we're trying to make it seem that it must have succeeded. Therefore, there is no pure, clear light there anymore. You see, that's what we tell ourselves. And we don't even look. But most of our attitudes are, well, we know that it must have succeeded in some way, so we just got to keep working at it. But if you actually look, you see it hasn't succeeded in the slightest bit. Not a trace. That's why you see this pure emptiness, as well, pure voidness, but it's not, it's pure clear lightness, where nothing is specified by God. The ground of being does not specify, has no preferences whatsoever for what arises. Therefore, you see no form whatsoever, no appearance whatsoever in the ground of being. This is the ground of being is our home. This is the nature of reality. Therefore, all is equally preferable. Total freedom to choose anything. There is no determinancy whatsoever, zero determinancy. Which means all options are available. And this is this wonderful, total fullness of potentiality. The clear, 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 pure, pure, pure light, as it were. So when you look, when you look at that, you see it, you say, oh wow, all our attempts to bring about preferences has failed. Hasn't had the slightest effect. Now, how do you know that? You take a peek. You take a peek. I took a peek recently. What was that, a week or two ago? I actually looked at our true nature and saw it. It's like perfect. I just said, it's perfect. Oh, wow. And then I reacted to it in a distraught manner because I said, how could I ever, why did I ever turn my back on this? You know, it's terrible. I'm trying to get over that now. So there are those who have looked at our true nature and see, oh, it hasn't changed at all. So we've had no effect on it. And then they realize, wow, this has all just been an effort to change what we are, and it's futile. And then they pass this information on to others, and so what we say here is we have a severe continuity problem. Even though we know, like, means to help evaporate the continuity fear, that's what we're doing. We still have this continuity fear, like, wow, it's so perfect. How could I turn away from this perfection? It's too much for me. It's too great for me. I'm just overcome. I was really overcome, really. That's a problem. See, that's really a problem. That's our real problem. And we have to keep working at it. So that's what we do here. So any practice has to be incorporated within the greater context of our continuity fear, which is our confession of a problem. We have a severe problem. So even this maybe meditation has to be incorporated within the greater context of my severe continuity problem. Is the only problem that I have. So one problem and one solution evaporated gradually evaporated. Now, some say your enlightenment's sudden. There's some, the Chan school, for instance, in China, Chan Buddhism, is a lot of that tends to say, well, sudden enlightenment. And I think the Theravada Buddhism is more like gradual, talking about that. This just for example. We say here it is gradual because of the continuity problem. For instance, we could get a glimpse of our true nature, but it's going to be so perfect, so incredibly perfect, we're going to go, oh, wow, it's too good for me. I'm not ready for that. I'm not used to that. I'm overwhelmed. I'm overcome with this. So we'll back off. So that's gradual. It's gradual. Now, at some point, it becomes steady, but it only becomes steady because of all the gradual work that we've done. What is meant by non-gradual, like Longchenpa, radical Dzogchen, means that there is no process involved in our impure nature, in our pure nature, our true nature. There's no gradualism there, you see. So the acceptance of no gradualism is what they're getting at. But you have to go towards that acceptance of no gradualism gradually. So, you know, that's just like that. Now, Jesus, you might call this what? Jesian teachings here, which are direct teachings from Jesus and not teachings from the religion of Christianity. You see, what we have here is Jesus direct. Jesian teachings. This is Jesian teachings. Or something like that. Is direct teachings from Jesus. Christianity is, you know, written by, you know, 100 years later, more, a lot of synods and councils and you know, saying, well, this is what we remember him saying, oral traditions and stuff like that. We have right now direct teachings of Jesus available. A Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, The Other Voice. These are direct. This is Jesus directly saying, these are the words I'm giving to you. And then, for instance, Dr. Brent Haskell, I believe he tape recorded them. And then from the tape recording, transcribed them directly into the book. They didn't add anything, didn't subtract anything. And of course, in Miracles is also very similar to that. And the flavor is very direct. Very, very direct. This is very intense. So the Jesian standpoint, we have a Jesian standpoint. A Joshuan standpoint. Joshuan, I guess he calls those Joshua. This is the Joshuan. I don't know how to say it, but we'll see. Our direct Christianity. This is direct Christianity. We're direct Christians. Meaning getting it straight from the horse's mouth. Straight from the horse's mouth. Jesus says, holy instance, it's gradual, gradual, gradual. You gradually, it's a gradual path. You move towards it, move towards it, move towards it, move towards it. But of course, in this way, no way does this deny the radical Dzogchen of Longchenpa in the slightest bit. Because the what we attain has no gradualism. What we attain has no gradualism. That is true. It's indeterminate, entirely indeterminate. So it's very important to keep our mind on eye on the prize of its reality is pure freedom, which is indeterminate, right? Meaning this, what I'm experiencing this moment does not determine what I'm going to experience the next moment. Doesn't influence it in any way. Past doesn't influence now, doesn't influence the future, now doesn't influence the future. There is no such thing, therefore, as time, space, process, form, really. How could we call time, meaningful time, if every moment is completely free and clear of every other moment with no influence whatsoever? It's all just this perpetual nowness, the eternal now is always, it's the freedom of each moment. We're always free. This is Joshua and direct Christianity. Direct Joshua and Christianity. Or Yeshua, direct Yeshua and Christianity. I don't know how you say Yeshua. Okay, Joshua, not Joshua, Yeshua. I don't know. Get some guidance on that. Direct Christianity. Straight from the horses, straight from the mouth of Yeshua, Jesus. From the mind, from the heart, from the compassion, from the clarity, from the home, from the reality, from the truth, from the freedom, straight from the freedom of Jesus, Yeshua, straight from the freedom of Jesus. Check in, see if you're remaining centered. Yeah. be aware of the strain, be aware of the struggle. And here we don't focus on the body at all. No focus on body sensations, reactions, anything. Just don't struggle with the struggle. Whatever struggle is going on, don't struggle with it. Don't focus on it. Don't amplify it. Don't minimize it. It's kind of it's an indeterminate, full stop, and indeterminism in the indeterminate. We're not trying to determine anything. But we are remaining centered, still calm, still not walking about and leaving where we are. Silent sitting. Or we could talk a little bit, but full stop in the indeterminacy of now, in the spontaneity of now. Don't pin ourselves down to, so de-emphasize the body for sure, body sensations, and never focusing on body sensations. You're vaguely aware that they're there, somewhat, but it's just an overall, just, I call it the burn. What it is just consternation. Like, where are my beliefs going? What's happening to my beliefs? What's happening to my expectations? I need an answer. I need an answer. Got to pay attention. What's the my question? I need an answer. I need concepts. I need determinism. And it's an agitation and a turmoil and a consternation over the lack of determinism. So it doesn't matter how it shows up sensation-wise in the body or anything. It doesn't matter. You just don't pay much attention at all. But you don't repress it or exclude it. You're aware, you're feeling the burns. Okay, the burn is there. That's fine. No problem. Just stick. Full stop in this indeterminacy. Full stop in indeterminacy. So it's just constant practicing of this every day that enables us then to just full stop in the maybe. Just maybe. No answers, just maybe. To whatever question or whatever arises as a question, just say, well, maybe. Is it this? Maybe. Is it that? Maybe. Are you succeeding? Maybe. Are you failing? Maybe. But just maybe. In other words, you don't have any answer. So it's giving an answer. It's giving no answer in the form of an answer, maybe. Now this really breaks the bathtub into. And it's enough. Like, I'm driving along today, and I'm trying to, every hour, half hour, trying to remind myself of the practice. And I just say, maybe, 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 maybe. Just my only response there is I have is just maybe. That's it. I don't have any other response to anything whatsoever. Just maybe. And just accept that, and you'll feel this burn. Just wow. My position on everything is just maybe. Whatever question arises is only maybe. Whatever anyone can ask is just maybe. I'm not coming up with any answers on anything whatsoever. I'm just taking the position of maybe. And also, Jesus recommends, what he recommends is, I don't know. I don't know. Is also very powerful. I'm going with maybe right now. It's the simplest, isn't it? But maybe. It's just one word, so easy to remember. Maybe. But I don't know if you prefer that. It's very similar. Also, I don't know. I don't know. Just a total I don't knowness to everything. I don't knowness. Because there's nothing to know. All is indeterminate. There's only indeterminacy. There isn't anything else. There's no world. There's no form. There's no dependent origination or dependent causation at all. There's just indeterminacy, actually. So, maybe they call us the Sergeant Schultz method. I know nothing. Nothing. Sorry for the television reference there, but I did actually watch long ago this Hogan Zeros and Sergeant Schultz. I know nothing. I know nothing. I know nothing. I know nothing. So we can just say, I know nothing. I don't know. I don't know. I know nothing. I know nothing. I don't know. But it's not a thing like I should know. Like, say, oh, I don't know the answer. Not apologize. I don't know the answer. No, I don't know anything. Period. This is my fundamental stance. I don't know this table. I don't know this chair. I don't know this mountain. I don't know this world. I don't know this universe. I don't know this body. I don't know this inquiry. I don't know this truth. I don't know anything. I don't know. And Jesus says, when we can say this with great positivity, then this is profoundly helpful, profoundly helpful. So this is sort of a new teaching. Can I put this teaching into like Buddhism? Not exactly, not really. There's so many variations there. And it actually doesn't fit so well. Because the determinant chain of determinant causation, you know, this is not what we're saying at all. And this is something fundamentally part of that. It's a different approach than Buddhism, actually. There, certainly the goal is the same. The goal is the same, but it's a different approach to for that goal. And It's really a new approach. It's really a new approach. It doesn't really fit into Christianity either. It doesn't really fit into any teaching that's coming forward. It's a direct Christianity approach. Direct Yeshuan approach. Yes approach. Yeshuan. The great Yeshuan approach. The Yeshuan approach. Yes. This is what works. But there's similarities for sure. Similarities for sure. Absolutely. But there's some fundamental differences too. And so we should not try to put new wine into old wineskin. Should not try to integrate, syncretize them, and all of this stuff. That gets very complicated. However, it's easy to transfer over to this new teaching, actually. Like, for instance, from Buddhism. It's easy because the centeredness, whatever practice you're doing, is the centeredness, composure, calm mind, all of that practice is super helpful. Super helpful. Super helpful. So anyone from any religious background can transfer over to this teaching, actually. And take the discipline, the dedication, the discipline, the non-reactiveness that they've been getting to, all of that fits right in with this I don't know, with this maybe, with this apex approach of maybe. This is really the apex approach, maybe or I don't know. There's nothing to know. And maybe is the stance of no stance at all, actually. But said in a positive way. It's the indeterminate stance, you see. It's no stance of no stance. Maybe. I don't know. I don't know. So, I find there's a tremendous benefit from the direct Yeshuan approach, direct Christianity. Getting the words directly from the teacher. A teacher like this, whereas in most teaching there's a lot of oral tradition. I mean, there's a ton of sutras in Buddhism that are written down. I mean, there was hundreds of years of oral tradition before anything was written down, actually. Christianity also, there was an oral tradition before it was written down. It's better to get it straight from the teacher's text. This is what I always pray for. I say, I want it straight from Jesus. I don't want interpretations, 2,000 years of interpretations, whether they come from popes or doctors of the church, are from bishops, are from various, you know, translators, synods, you know. I mean, there's a synod, a council of bishops right now in Rome looking into family values, and they're looking to see if they can't rewrite the basic canon, position on family values. Okay, so they come up with a vote, they take input the vote, and they say, now they're going to say, well, this is what the Holy Spirit wants, this is, you know, this is what now is true. Well, this is a vote. I'd rather get it straight, you know, get it straight from Yeshua. He never says anything about those issues, though. So maybe we shouldn't be emphasizing him so much, actually. And this is what I find. It is your life will automatically flow in a certain way when you put truth first, you see. So we don't really need to structure everything out and come up with all these rules and regulations. What we need to do, if everyone is actually practicing, then they'll realize, oh, we structured around our practice, of course. It's a no-brainer. It's completely self-evident. So I believe Jesus takes this approach. He doesn't seem to really chime in on all these issues that are just boiling in this world. You know, he just says, I don't know. I don't know. Practice I don't know-ism. IDK-ism. Maybe this is the approach, is IDK-ism. Maybe-ism. Man, IDK-ism. Buddhism, IDKism, I don't know-ism. But of course, the ego always say, oh no, it's just like what was before, then throw you back into this massive swamp of so many, many, many opinions and writings, and I mean, every school of Buddhism has all their sutras, you know, that they're based key sutras, and they're all very different in every possible direction. I mean, it's just like a massive, you know, historical river with tributaries and deltas, and this massive delta with so many things. See, our whole purpose here is to streamline it, streamline everything. That's always been my purpose, my goal. Streamline spiritual teaching here in this world, streamline it, super simplify it. So we're not going to go for any of this, you know, oh, let's throw this into this context. No, we're not throwing it into any other context at all. This is the streamlined, simple, streamlined, direct transmission from truth itself, from Yeshua, from Jesus, IDKism. And we keep it simple. We keep it simple. So simple. Full stop in the burn. Full stop in the burnism. Because when you say, I don't know. And this is what Jesus is leading to. This is a very direct, very fast, very simple, streamlined approach. There's no question about it. And, you know, I'm just waking up to it, just realizing, oh yeah, because comparing it to comparative religion and all that scholarship, you can see, he says, okay, yeah, this is absolutely streamlined. And some are ready for that. We don't need to wade through all those questions of comparativism. How does it derive from this? And I don't know, is the answer, right? I don't know. Well, is it like this? Is it more like Vajrayana? I don't know. Maybe. Is this what the Buddha taught? Maybe. Is it more Theravada or Mahayana? Well, is it Theravada? Maybe. Is it Mahayana? Maybe. Is it synthesis of them? Maybe. Or, I don't know. I don't know. Is this teaching effective? I don't know. Or maybe. Is this teaching from Jesus? Maybe. See, whatever the question is, maybe. Or, I don't know. This is the technique, even when you say, is truth true? Maybe. In other words, no position on it. And this opens the door to the clear light. Frees you from the fear of it. Because you realize there is no specification whatsoever in reality. No preference, no specification, no judgment. Love makes absolutely no judgment whatsoever. And if we're bound in concepts, however lofty the concepts are, people will say, well, isn't that what Buddha was getting at? Maybe. Or, I don't know. So in other words, don't allow anything to pull you away from your practice. It's the whole key to the situation. And, of course, the ego will get furious at this. The burn, you know, the burn. You'll get furious at it. But through your practicing, you maintain your composure. So, this way, IDKism welcomes everyone from all traditions, those mature practitioners from all traditions, to take this very, you know, rapid ascent, actually, which is full stop in the burn. I don't know. So, as Punjaji, the great Advaitin realizer, said, no, the best route, you want to know the best route? We said, what is my teaching? The best route is no teaching, no teacher, no student. Very true. Someone asked him, if I want to really be enlightened quickly, what do I do? He said, just sit quietly. No teacher, no teaching, no teacher, no student. Just sit quietly. This is very true. But it's easier said than done, you know. So you have to be very mature to take this on. Very mature to take this on. But how do you get that maturity? You work every day at it. It's difficult. Very difficult. So this is an apex teaching, an Adi Yoga teaching. Not everybody can handle it, that is for sure. Of course not. The burn is intense. I don't know. I have no answers whatsoever. I don't know. Of course, we don't need answers, do we? See, that's the whole point of it, right? Reality doesn't need any answers. Reality's not in need of any answers. Reality doesn't need to know anything. Reality's not in the need of knowledge. Reality doesn't need anything at all. It's not in need of realization. So, someone asks, are you realized? Maybe. 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 You might think, it's easy for you to say that. You've been practicing for so long. The burn is still there, intense. You know, it's like, wow. So you're supposed to bring this burn upon yourself. but not more than you can handle. See, this is the key. This is where the patience comes in. So that's why I say no caffeine with this Hatha Yoga approach, this Yeshuan approach, this IDK approach. Yeshuan approach of IDKism. Yes, 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 I know nothing. I don't know. I just turned into Sergeant Schultz. I don't know. I don't know. Very important. I don't know is an IDKism. Supposed to feel the burn. Evaporating this continuity fear here. Because the clear light is there. It's here for us. No question about it. This is our quote-unquote future. This is what we're moving into, for sure. So we better be ready. Does this have an effect? Yes, it can have an effect. It can result in some sleeplessness. Absolutely. Is a strain? Absolutely, it's a strain. But stay away from stimulants. Tea, coffee, soft drinks with caffeine in it, cigarettes. Don't use any stimulants. Don't use any drugs, for sure. Do not use any drugs. This is forbidden in this way. You won't be able to do it. Because this is just the root of intensity itself. I don't know. This is stating indeterminacy here. And this just shakes the whole structure of determinacy entirely. And so you don't want to overdo it. Don't want to overdo it. And it is a strain. No question it's a strain. So why are we doing this now? Because we're under pressure. The whole world's under incredible pressure, as I pointed out so often. Call it drastic pressure. Drastic pressure to choose determinism for your future. To choose determinism. To reinvest in determinism, the belief system of determinism. And that's a terrible, terrible thing, situation to get into. Terrible. You end up building in terrible habits of attention. And you end up in a bizarre sort of masquerade. Bizarre Mardi Gras of mummers and masqueraders. You just become very eccentrically bizarre, actually. And that frightens you, actually. You're disturbed. You know, become deeply disturbed. So it's worth the strain. And you have to have some faith. It will happen for you. It will happen for you without trying to force it. Without trying to force the issue too much. Don't use drugs to try to enforce the issue. Drugs are often used by those who don't have this stable foundation. You know, it's the Western way of, well, I got no stable foundation. I don't know how to center myself at all. So I got no time. I just got to push through right now, today. I'm going to, this is it. because I don't have a stable foundation of practice. I can't do it, so I just have to do it all at once. You know, disaster. You can have mental breakdowns if you do it. Try to do that. Mental illness, mental breakdowns, absolutely. You try to force them with drugs. So, what I'm showing here is, hey, there's a way to do it. You don't need drugs. Don't use drugs, you'll get in trouble. Now, most people who use drugs, they're not even trying for, you know, for the clear light, so it doesn't really matter. They're just having recreational, you know, sensations and whatever. But for those who try to use it as a sacrament to push through to enlightenment, this is a big problem. There is no high spiritual tradition, really, that advocates the use of drugs. There's not. Those who know what they're talking about know very well what they're talking about. And that can get you into a lot of trouble. So this, maybe, I don't know this, IDK in this meditation. It's not like being stoned on drugs or pot or something. Not at all. It's got its own buzz to it. It's a different buzz, very much different. It's a spiritual buzz. It's this burn. It's this wow. It's this like, wow. How can I? This is just incredible. You know, it's totally different. Apples and oranges. Cannot compare the two at all. To compare the two at all is to lose sight of the preciousness of it, you know. To try to put this approach into some other comparative talk is to lose sight of the preciousness of it. Absolutely. The absolute simplicity of it, the tremendous simplicity of this approach. However you could stay centered, you can do that. You can watch your breath if you want to, or, you know, mindfulness techniques, whatever technique you're used to, you can use that, absolutely. Full stop in the burn. See, the apex approach is focused on what? I mean, for example, in Buddhism they say when you take the raft across the river, no matter what kind of boat or raft you use, when you get to the other side, you're done with it. Yeah, you're done with it. So however you're remaining centered, full stop, and I don't know. We're practicing letting go of the raft, so to speak. I don't know. Did you use this raft? Maybe. How about this one? Maybe. Is this your approach? Maybe. Is that approach? Maybe. Maybe, 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 maybe. I don't know. It's letting go of all technique, all practice. So we have to practice this. We have to practice letting go. I'll jump in the release. All is released. Even release is released by the absence of anything brought before release. Is a way to put it too. Even release in the absence of anything brought to release. You know, What path did you take? I don't know. Did you take this path? Maybe. How about this one? Maybe. Yeah, maybe I did. It was like spiritual Alzheimer's, you know. Totally irrelevant. It becomes totally irrelevant. Because there is no path. Remember, all this is an attempt to change what we are. And it's futile. So we're just setting it down. We never went anywhere. There's nowhere to go. If there's nowhere to go, we never went anywhere. How can we return? There's no returning. So you take the raft over the river, get on the other side, and then you start realizing, hey, wait a minute. I never left this side. There is no river. It was all a dream. It was all a dream. So what does it matter what raft I took over in a dream? It was all unreal in the first place. So I don't know. Did you take this? Maybe. Is this kind of teaching to use it? Maybe. Total spiritual Alzheimer's, you know, or intentionally. What about this teacher? Do you know the teacher? Maybe. Did you listen? Did you study what they said? Maybe. Were they helpful? Maybe. Maybe. Was this one not helpful? Maybe. Was it difficult? Maybe. Was it easy? Maybe. So what you're doing is you're letting go of a viewpoint. There's no viewpoint. Reality doesn't need a viewpoint. There's no preferences. There is no viewpoint. There's only fundamental freedom, spontaneity and freedom, but there's no viewpoint. There's no I, there's no viewpoint. So what we're doing is we're sort of melting, releasing this viewpointness, viewpointism. Was this your viewpoint? Maybe. Is this your viewpoint? Maybe. How about this? Is that your viewpoint? Maybe. Do you have a viewpoint? Maybe. Are you free? If you're free of a viewpoint? Maybe. You see this? Because having the viewpoint that you're free of a viewpoint is also a viewpoint. So we'll just say maybe. Have you transcended viewpoint? Maybe. And see, the ego can't trap us in any way, so we practice this, being free of being trapped by the ego. Are you trapped by the ego? Maybe. Are you free of the ego? Maybe. See, there's nothing to be free from. We are free. There's only freedom. There's only indeterminacy. It's not indeterminacy free from determinacy. There is no determinacy. There's only isness. So the practice is maybe, 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 you see. You cannot conceptualize isness. It can only be, you know, experienced. And there's nothing that can be said about it. There's no viewpoint on it. There's no viewpoint on it. So we're practicing no viewpoint, no viewpoint. Maybe, 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 maybe. Maybeism. Maybeism, IDKism. So I'm practicing it right now. Are the Giants going to win the World Series? Maybe. Are Kansas City Royals going to win the World Series? Maybe. Like that. Just maybe. Am I going to watch the games? Maybe. So this just, you know, just melts the ego structure of viewpointism. And as you feel like, there's no viewpoint. What's my viewpoint? I don't know. What's my viewpoint? I don't know. That's my viewpoint. I don't know. Is that your viewpoint? I don't know. I mean, no, is I don't know your viewpoint. I don't know. And this is when the burn, see, the burn gets in. Now, there's some spiritual teachers, you know, do skillful means with those who are mature and bring this burn up. They certainly know how to do that. Very valid, very valid. Some of the non-dual teachers, Neo-Vedanta teachers, they'll probably, I don't know, but probably, you know, they can do this. Although, the problem there is, one can hear about this technique and hear about this and intellectualize and say, hey, I can be a teacher now. It's easy. All I have to do is just throw it back, you know, on the student, you know, and but they may have not themselves. They may still be operating from a viewpoint. And what they want is they want themselves to be their viewpoint, you know. So, just keep practicing. Just keep practicing. Is this teacher legit? I don't know. No viewpoint. And a little bit goes a long ways. Once you get this burn going, wow, you know, it can really hit you hard like a sledgehammer. And if the teacher wants themselves to be the viewpoint, then they can easily transfer your feeling of like, wow, you know, to them, you see. And that's when problems arise down the road, problems arise then down the road. Because then they need the teacher to function, you know, they need the teacher to, otherwise they feel that they'd be thrown into a void. So they haven't crossed the void, as it were. Crossing the void, this is crossing the void. What is the void? It's a mistaken interpretation. It's a determinate view of indeterminacy, is the quote-unquote void. The void doesn't exist. But this practice is what we're doing. We're crossing the void here. This is the Ati Yoga, for instance, of Longchenpa Radical Dzogchen, crossing across the void. And, you know, of course it's scary. You're like, wow. But you realize it's just a burn. It's just consternation. So you don't struggle with it. When you get scared is when you struggle with the struggle. That's when troubles start. But if you just say, oh, okay, I'm really agitated in this consternation. I want a viewpoint. Where's my viewpoint? I'm upset about it. You say, okay, that's fine. That's great. That's exactly what we're aiming for here. Just full stop in that. Resting on the clarification that this clear light is not emptiness, it's the form of everything, it's the form of spontaneity, where everything is present. That's how everything is present. Everything's an idea. There's no form to it whatsoever. Everything is present without any preference. The reason why it seems empty is no form there, no formness, there's no preference. The ground of being has no preference. So it shows that everything is there. See? So what we're doing is we're crossing the void, this mistaken belief in the void by this practice, IDKism. Which is, again, relates to the Ati Yoga of Radical Dzogchen, the Longchenpa Ati Yoga. The apex, which is just this void crossing, which isn't a void. And this is unavoidable, actually. And struggle with the struggle. That's what I mean. Full stop in the burn. Don't struggle with the struggle. Just smile and say, this is great. This really a severe burn going on here. really upset. That's great. Don't do anything. Just be indeterminate about it. No, not forced indeterminacy. Just hang loosely in indeterminacy. Don't try to bring anything to rest. Don't try to bring anything to rest, see? So. This is kind of a fusion of Jesus and Long Jhampa, actually. So we call it the Jipa teachings. Yeshua. Yepa teachings. Teachings of Yepa. Yeshua and Long Jhampa. The Yepa teachings. Are these the Yepa teachings? I don't know. I don't know. Jepa, the Jepa teachings, Jepa Jeshua, Yeshua, Yepa, Yepa Jeshua, Jepa, Yepa, Yepa Depa Do. So crossing the void is this simple. This is what's happening. This is what's happening. Is, you see, there is no void. There is no void at all. In the dream, I had this moving van. I asked, what's my future going to be? You know, what am I going to move into next? This big, you know, moving van, like an Beacons or whatever, Mayflower moving van. And I was like on a platform, and it's kind of a high platform, and beneath me, it was a drop off to the landscape below. It's like, so it's kind of like, wow, how do I get down there? It's kind of like a voidness, you know. And the van back right up to the platform, and then the door, the back door of the van, you know, like a ramp, poof, came down on the platform, so I could just walk straight into this totally, quote unquote, empty van, which was simply full of allness, full of allness, full of allness, full of allness. You see, you could walk straight into it. So, cross the void that way. Crossing the non-existent void. So you may say, oh, people are going to ask me, well, what is this? This sounds like this. Is it this? Is it this? Is it this? You say, I don't know. Maybe. Maybe. Maybe it is. Yeah, maybe. And just keep this position of maybe. Which is humble, right? We're talking about humility. The meek shall inherit the kingdom, actually. The meek, meaning you're not all opinionated, saying, you know, yeah, or this or no. That. But maybe, 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 maybe. Very humble, right? Because people judge you on your ability to be decisive, so yes or no. And we're just saying, maybe. And they say, wow, you just don't really know. Say, I don't know. I don't know. I don't know. But generally, see, this I don't know-ism is, IDK-ism is, it's a positive thing. It's not, again, saying, it's not like, I'm not sure. No, I'm sure that I don't know. I am absolutely sure. I am sure that I don't know. I'm absolutely sure that I don't know. See the difference, right? I'm sure that I don't know. Is IDK, I'm sure, I don't know. So one of the ways to just use it is just maybe, maybe. I'm sure it's maybe, meaning I'm sure I don't know. So when we are crossing the non-existent void, we do to speak without level confusion here, This is a sign that we are evaporating the continuity fear. It is certainly a sign. Evaporating the continuity fear. Very much strongly evaporating it. So someone said, well, what stage are you on? What stage are you at? What stage of, I don't know. What stage of concentration or samadhi are you at? I don't know. Well, is it, have you reached some kind of nirvana or samadhi? I don't know. Maybe. Are you going to the Pure Land? Maybe. Are you going to be reborn? Maybe. Are you a non-returner? Maybe. Have you been saved by the blood of Christ? Maybe. Are you saved? Maybe. Are you liberated? Maybe. Remember, no viewpoint. Reality has no viewpoint. There's nothing you can say about it. Is it a liberated state? Maybe. You see, like that. We got a tiny bit of precipitation here in California today. Tiny bit, just enough to dampen things a little bit. I was sitting in the truck and there was a little mist was coming down, no faint drizzle. And someone ran out of the building and they'd like raised their hands and she like this and like, wow, you know, and then somebody else came out later, the same thing. They were running back in until, hey, everybody, it's raining. And they're running outside and they say, oh my gosh, it's raining. This is incredible. Just enough to get the windshield a little drizzling a little bit here. Drizzle like this, drizzle is like a big event for us right now. Yeah, we're keeping our fingers crossed that a deluge comes this winter. Otherwise, we're in big trouble. Everybody's still watering their lawns. It's unbelievable. Driving around through communities, sprinklers, and you can tell in the morning the sprinklers are on heavily. The lawns are lush, green. I'm just saying, wow. Yeah, people just, you know, they won't break their habits. You know, it's so their status is so important for them. Hey, I can afford a gardener. Look how lush my lawn is. I don't have to cut my lawn. You know, it's a sign of status, and they don't want to give it up. It's amazing, isn't it? So, if you ask, you know, what could the future of the world be dystopian? Well, that's the answer right there. Yeah. Maybe, yeah, maybe it could be dystopian, because people will not change their habits even in the face of drastic problems. They won't. Unless you pass a law mandating no lawns, you know, they will not change. They'll basically say, well, I'll just keep going as long as I possibly can, and that's it. Whereas I was able to hardscape everything here, it's all hardscape, you know, minimal water use in every way. So, okay, you know, bite the bullet. You know, it's time to do that. But no, that's, you know, everybody has a lawn. It's incredible. What do they need lawns for, really? Think about it. Biggest pain in the world is a lawn. Have to weed it, have to fertilize it, have to water it, have to mow it, have to edge it. You know, it is the most horrible pain there is. I hate lawns, having to deal with lawns. And yet, here, it's just, you've got to have a lawn. If you're American, you have to have a lawn. Yes, period. Now, artificial lawns are available. And I some people I know have these artificial lawns, and they look fabulous, actually. But they're expensive, is the problem. There's a lot to it. A lot goes into it, apparently. So they're not cheap, but a real good artificial lawn looks beautiful. I mean, I saw one that I thought it was a real lawn. And I had to actually go up to it and touch the grass. And even then I said, is this real or not? And it looks just beautiful. No mowing, no watering. You see, just take a blower and blow the leaves off if you need to. Yeah, And so you got your status right there. You say, oh, okay, there's your nice little green, emerald green, you know. I wonder if golf courses in California are going to put in, you know, fake grass. Because a lot of them don't have any water, that's for sure. Maybe they'll be hitting off of dirt pretty soon, actually. Some of them use reclaimed water from, you know, reclaimed water from all the, you know, irrigation, sewage, whatever, all the stuff that goes into processed and plants as reclaimed water. So, but that may be grabbed up for agriculture here. California has a severe problem, actually. It's severe. I'm even thinking, you know, all those prophets of doom saying California's going to break up and fall in the ocean. Well, if they keep pumping all the water from all the underground, massive underground reservoir, which the entire Central Valley of California is underneath it, is, you know, it's a, just a massive, massive valley. I mean, how was it? Almost 1,000 miles long or something? 100 miles wide. I mean, it's just incredible, massive. Underneath all of that is a huge lake, huge water reservoir, massive reservoir underneath all of that. They're pumping it all out. You know, there's not going to be anything left there. I'm just wondering if that may trigger earthquakes. It may cause the land to collapse in some way or settle or some way, you know. And if you have bad enough earthquake in California, you get bad enough earth movements, actually. I mean, the Sacramento Delta, that whole region, if it all dropped and the huge earthquakes and the levees all failed and the land started subsiding severely quickly and stuff because all was pumping water out, you could have the entire Pacific Ocean flood into the Central Valley, as a matter of fact. It just filled the complete Central Valley up with ocean, which would add tremendous additional weight in some ways, may change the whole vectors of the situation, and you may have even more severe earthquakes. So, I mean, it's not impossible that California could break up into islands and stuff, which as many have said will happen. I don't know. It's funny to speculate about it. Just like, wow, what a time we live in, right? Maybe all those so-called kooks who talked about earth changes, maybe they might turn out not be so wrong. I don't know. How's the future going to be? I don't know. I don't know anything, actually. I don't know at all. I'm sure I don't know. But this is different than prognosticating, you see. It's very different than prognosticating. It's a complete maybe to everything. Will we have earth changes? Maybe. Will we avoid the earth changes? Maybe. It's all maybe. I don't know. I mean, there is no determinism. There is no viewpoint on anything whatsoever. There's nothing happening. Nothing ever happens, actually. So if someone says, is this going to happen? I don't know. Maybe. Nothing ever happens. Nothing has ever happened. There's never been any causality whatsoever. Not even dependent causality. That hasn't happened either. People will say, well, what do you mean by that? Is this what you mean by that? I don't know, maybe. I don't know, maybe. So there isn't really a dialogue here. This is Apex Yoga. There's no dialogue here. See, we're completely moving away from that. Totally. We're moving into practice, actually. We're crossing the void. Crossing the void is practice. You have to stay on point here. Stay in the boat. The boat of baby. So, is this what you mean? You do kind of mean this? Maybe. Okay, maybe. Well, like that? Maybe. Maybe. So, where's the dialogue? There's no dialogue. See, dialogue is just trying to determine which point of view is the correct one. We're crossing the voidness of no point of view, which is it actually is not a void at all. It's reality, which is freedom. Freedom is not a point of view. You could say it's all points of view, which is formless, actually, isn't it? What is the form of everything? Clear light, isn't it? Total clear light. Undisturbed peace, undisturbed tranquility, undisturbed love, undisturbed freedom. Don't struggle with the struggle. So here in these videos, we're really getting to it, actually. Really getting to it. Don't struggle with the struggle. If you can do this, don't struggle with the struggle, and yet you're burning. Of course, there's a burn. Like, wow. I just don't get this. I don't know. The burn is there. Don't struggle with it. You can maintain your calm, your poise like that. Then that's all you need to know. I don't know is all you need to know. But yeah, that's you're succeeding. You're succeeding then. And don't struggle with that. Just say, okay. And if the ego says, oh, are you succeeding? Say, maybe. Maybe. No position. Don't get trapped in any position. Neither position of success nor position of failure nor anything in between. There is no void. There's no viewpoint of a void, neither is there a viewpoint of not a void. So it's not like realization arrives and then you can say, guess what, everybody, I have a viewpoint for y'all. Come and get it. It doesn't work that way. That's why everybody's hanging back waiting to say, well, I'm just waiting for the right viewpoint. So I'm waiting for some great savior to come along and give me the right viewpoint. You know, they wait in vain, entirely in vain. There is no viewpoint to be given out whatsoever. It's the realization, this realization that what we think is the void is actually the total plenum. It's the allness. It's the I amness, the allness. It's not a void, it's the allness. This is the realization. So those who wait for a viewpoint and wait in vain, wait in vain, wait in vain. Which is why I've told everybody my whole life, I've tried to tell people, no, you've got to practice, work at this. And they all outsmart themselves. They say, oh, I'm the one who has the supple mind, so I'm sure I'll get the right viewpoint. See, I'll be able to fashion a viewpoint. Don't worry. Yeah, I have a supple mind. Wait in vain. Those are the ones who simply says, well, we'll worship you as soon as you give us the right viewpoint, then we'll worship you. We'll idolize you. There's no viewpoint to give. Idolaters are always out of luck. They say, hey, we're going to run out of water. Now I got to water my lawn. listen. They don't listen. You can lead a horse to water, you can't make him drink. This is what I found out. Most people will just say, no, the void is there. I got the severe continuity fear. The void, there's no way. I need a viewpoint. I say, I need a viewpoint to cross the void. No, you cross the viewpoint by practicing giving. You cross the void by practicing giving up viewpointness. That's how you, and as you do that, you realize there is no void. There is no void. This isn't a void. This is allness. It's perfection. It's freedom. So, I got all sorts of chips, Tostitos, of different types of potato chips. I've got guacamole, I've got salsa, I've got sour cream dip, I've got sunflower seeds, I've got some dates, I've got popcorn, I've got some diet root beer. Okay, got ready for the World Series. So everything is just the snacks to relieve the insane tension of it all. The torture, I got my torture towel, you know, there's very little, if you want burn, if you just be like a severe baseball fan, your team's in the World Series, you want torture, we call it Giants baseball torture, because it is torture. The way they win games, just barely win games, and it's so close and so tight, and any little thing, anything happens is going to change the outcome of the game, and you're just like, ah. I remember the first 2010, took me a year to recover. I was so completely tortured by that. I wanted to win so bad, I was just tortured. 2012, I said, I'm not going to do that again. Took it very smooth. Yeah. No torture. I mean, no problem recovering. No recovery problem. And right now, I'm fine. So, you can still enjoy without struggling with the struggle, you know. So, it's just the same thing with this meditation. IDKism is just full stop in the burn. The burn's there, but you're not struggling with it. So the torture is there. But you say, okay, it's great. This is torture. Just don't let your nervous system get trapped into struggling with the struggle where you turn into this massive, colossal drama of struggle and you're being crushed by the struggle and all this stuff. You can still enjoy the game. Enjoy. It's funny. It's really amazing. The Giants are really amazing team. They're the most entertaining team in sports, in my opinion. They just continue to do the improbable, the amazing comeback, and just the way they just seem to always prevail. It's just truly quite incredible, quite entertaining. World Series is very entertaining. But hang loose, relax, hang loose. It just... don't struggle with the struggle. Is this one going to get a hit? Maybe. I say, maybe. Is this what's going to happen? Maybe. Maybe it will, maybe. Just try to practice. You can practice like that. Maybe. Maybe, maybe, maybe. Maybe, maybe. Now, if the Giants win, then it's a dynasty. Really the greatest dynasty in National League history. St. Louis had the three World Series wins in 5 years back in the 40s. Those are the war years. I mean, everybody's off to war, you know. All the roster's completely depleted, and it doesn't have the same significance as right now, actually. So, you know, it's a dynasty. Three wins in 5 years is incredibly difficult to do. And it's just so difficult to keep your focus. It's like a meditation of its own almost to keep your eye on the prize. Keep your eye on the prize. And, you know, it is just brutally difficult. But it's doable. It's doable, see? So what we're doing, crossing this void in realizing no viewpointness, you know, is like a dynastic effort, really. It's a dynastic effort in a way. It's a supreme effort to keep your eye on the prize and not settle for some viewpoint, you know, not settle for some viewpoint. And of course, the world will pressure you to adopt a viewpoint. And I've had this my whole life. I came out of the world trying to bring this into the world. Everybody said, well, what's your viewpoint? And you have to have a viewpoint. And I said, no, no, and they keep pressuring. Eventually, I succumbed. I said, I gotta find a viewpoint. So I've spent my whole life looking for a viewpoint. And now I'm saying, no, there is no viewpoint. Able to at least assert it a little bit, which is a great, great, great step to take. So, go Giants. Go Giants. But are they, will they win? Maybe, 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 maybe. I don't know. I don't know, I don't know, I don't know. Anyway, this, enjoy this video greatly. It's really brought us right up to date right now of what's going on here. And so just do it, you know. Keep your eye on the prize. Just keep your poise. Just this full stop. Don't struggle with the struggle. And of course, this fear, no viewpoint, is going to be jumping all over the place like a jumping bean, you know. But don't struggle with the struggle. Just let it jump around. And you might be saying, well, that's not very spiritual. I should have a viewpoint on this. No, just let it jump around. Gradually you'll get more and more disinterested in it, jumping around. All this jumping around this should become more and more disinterested. This is just the world, in, you know, that you're clinging to. The effort to change reality is you're clinging to the effort. It's jumping all around. You become less and less interested in it until you realize there's no void. There's no reason for this. I don't need to hold on to this. There's no void. And then you just your attention is no longer on it at all, eventually. And no attention to it whatsoever is. Peace of mind, eventually, see? Peace of mind. Peace of mind. Okay, very great. That's it. And go Giants.